To be joining us in this worship service. I'm the Reverend Hugh Reed, and on behalf of the Reverend Carrie Stover and the congregation of Kingsway Lambton United Church, I welcome you to another edition of Kingsway Lambton Worships at Home, this on Sunday, July the 5th, the fifth Sunday in the season of Pentecost. I also welcome any who are joining us from Lake Joseph Community Church on Lake Joseph in Muskoka. I was supposed to be the guest speaker there this morning. I was supposed to be in Muskoka. And as all our schedules have changed with this pandemic, so was mine. But in their wisdom, the board of Lake Joe decided that they would join their guest speakers at their home churches or wherever they were preaching. So I welcome you who are joining us from Lake Joe. And I'll tell you, I am at this moment trying to imagine that cool breeze coming off the lake. Oh, I smell that Muskoka air. It is kind of hot and sultry here. I welcome you to our West Reception Room today. It's an appropriate place to receive people. It's also an appropriate place because the theme of the service today is going to reflect on stories of beginning. A lot of stories happen in this room. A lot of stories are told. Of course, we have a lot of meetings here. We have our stewards meetings and UCW meetings and knitters meetings and our Bible studies and our week of guided prayer. Lots of different events and meetings happen in this room, and a lot of them involve sharing stories. I think more particularly of the funeral receptions that happen here. When our Unit 2 provides an elegant tea and those delicious church sandwiches, and we gather with those who are remembering to share stories. And just over here, I often, a few days before a funeral, will gather with a family to listen to their stories about their loved one. It is walking on holy ground. And I always like to start at the beginning. I'll be reflecting on that in my meditation in the course of the service, but now I, at the beginning, as usual, like to thank our music director, Ian Grundy, and our section leads. We're moving into our summer services now, so not every Sunday we'll have all our section leads. We're going to be missing Emily's voice this Sunday. At the same time, we really appreciate those who continue to add their gifts of music. And today and through the summer, we'll be hearing, rather than anthems, solos in our service. And today, Nathan Gritter is going to be giving a very moving rendition of Mendelssohn's "If With All Your Hearts Ye Will Seek Me." And I thank Nathan for his contribution to our service today. I thank you for joining us. It is wonderful to be with you, to worship with you on this July the 5th. It is wonderful to breathe that Muskoka air. I invite you now to join in the call to worship, which will appear shortly on your screen. I'll say the part marked one. I invite you to respond in your own place, at your own pace, in the part marked all. Then we'll join together in our opening hymn, "Dear Weaver of Our Lives' Design." Let us worship God. Come, gather, breathe, you who have borne the burden of the week and the heat of the day. Let us join together in our opening hymn. Gather together now as one extended family joined in the risen life and love of our Lord Jesus Christ. Let us join our hearts together in prayer. Let us pray. O gracious Lord, in different places we gather together in a difficult time. Some are losing patience with this long patient struggle against a pandemic. Some are growing afraid for businesses, afraid for loved ones. Some are not sure where they are in their story. We gather together for worship, for a time of refreshing. Pour out your Holy Spirit upon us, that we may drink deeply in this time of your love, that we may be aware of your presence with us, that we may grow more deeply aware of being part of your story, still unfolding through this pandemic and in spite of this pandemic, as we are your partners in love. Thank you for this privilege of worship, and thank you for these wonderful friends to worship with. In Jesus' name, amen. Let us join together in our prayer of confession and renewal. Let us pray. Lord, your redeeming word of love and acceptance is rest for the weary and a light for our paths. Forgive us when we seek rest where there is no rest. Forgive us our missed opportunities to forgive, to love, to heal, to grow. By what you have done in Jesus for all creation, you have revealed true life, given eternal life, and opened every moment for new life. Restore us to you and to one another in this summer season of rest, growth, and renewal. In Jesus' name, amen. Friends, remember and believe that anyone in Jesus Christ is a new creation. Behold, the past is finished and gone, the new has come. Whatever would hold your life to some bitterness, to a sin, or to a wound, has no right to your future. Our sins are forgiven. From this day forward, walk in newness of life. And thanks be to God. Amen. And may the peace of our Lord Jesus Christ be with you all. Please take a moment now to wish the peace of Christ to someone who may be near you. Take a moment if there is no one near or if there is someone on your heart to say a prayer. Enfold them in Christ's peace through your prayer and through your thinking about them. And then let them know that you have given a thought to them, that they are on your heart. They will appreciate it. Take some time now, please, to share the peace of Christ with those near and those far. And may Christ's peace dwell deeply and richly in you in every moment of every day. Amen. Now for our good news candle on this Sunday, July the 5th of 2020. For birthdays and anniversaries, once again, we'll work from later in this coming week to today. So on this coming Saturday, Eldon and Dorothy Morrell celebrate their 67th wedding anniversary. Congratulations to Eldon and Dorothy. On Friday, we remember Steve Prime's birthday, and I remember John Calvin, the great theologian's birthday. On Wednesday, Priscilla Knight, who has really been a knight in shining armor for her leadership during this COVID time, has her birthday, July the 8th, and I hope it is a wonderful one. Priscilla, thanks for all your efforts for us. And today, Charles and Dorothy Donnelly, two wonderful servants of this congregation and two wonderful people, celebrate their 51st wedding anniversary. And I hope it's by the cooling breezes of Lake Huron. I wanted to light it too for May Hampton and Jean Train, sisters who have sister time while watching the service on Sunday mornings. Though they're separated by a few miles, Jean here and May in Kingston, they are together with us, and it's so wonderful to have you two with us. So maybe you can join with Charles or Chuck and Dot. May and Jean, can you blow out this match for us as we celebrate the good news we share in the light of Jesus, the light of the world. And on the count of three, one, two, three. Good job. Amen. Let us join together in the prayer Jesus taught us. Let us pray. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our sins as we forgive those who sin against us. Save us from the time of trial and deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Amen. As we come to the offering, once again, I just simply express my thanks for all the ways that you are supporting your church and what we are trying to accomplish through this time of COVID and through all times in this world, which needs to know the love of God and to feel the service of God's love. I also thank you again for all you are doing to support your community in every way as we make progress against this terrible illness and as we continue to seek to be part of the story of God. Let us give thanks for being part of the promise. Let us join our hearts in prayer. O gracious God, receive these our gifts, together with the worship and service of our whole lives. Use them and us, that all might know your promise unfolding in their lives. In Jesus' name, amen. Our scripture lesson for this Sunday comes from the 24th chapter in the book of Genesis. I would recommend you read all 67 verses when you get a chance. It's a wonderful little novella. We read selected verses today. It is the story of Rebekah at the well. It begins with Abraham sending his most faithful and oldest servant off to find a wife for Rebekah in Abraham's hometown. Listen for the word of God. Then the servant took 10 of his master's camels and departed, taking all kinds of choice gifts from his master. And he set out and went to Aram Naharaim, to the city of Nahor. He made the camels kneel down outside the city by the well of water. It was toward evening, the time when women go out to draw water. And he said, O Lord God of my master Abraham, please grant me success today and show steadfast love to my master Abraham. I am standing here by the spring of water, and the daughters of the townspeople are coming out to draw water. Let the maiden to whom I say, please lower your jar that I may drink, and who replies, drink, and I will also water your camels, let her be the one whom you have decreed for your servant Isaac. Thereby shall I know that you have dealt graciously with my master. Before he had finished speaking, there was Rebekah, who was born to Bethuel, son of Milcah, the wife of Nahor, Abraham's brother, coming out with her water jar on her shoulder. The girl was very fair to look upon, a virgin whom no man had known. She went down to the spring, filled her jar, and came up. Then the servant ran to meet her and said, please, let me sip a little water from your jar. Drink, my lord, she said, and quickly lowered her jar upon her hand and gave him a drink. When she had finished giving him a drink, she said, I will draw water for your camels also until they have finished drinking. So she quickly emptied her jar into the trough and ran again to the well to draw, and she drew for all his camels. The man gazed at her in silence to learn whether or not the Lord had made his journey successful. When the camels had finished drinking, the man took a gold nose ring weighing half a shekel and 2 gold bands for her arms, 10 shekels in weight. Pray tell me, he said, whose daughter are you? Is there room in your father's house for us to spend the night? She replied, I am the daughter of Bethuel, the son of Milcah, whom she bore to Nahor. She went on, there is plenty of straw and feed at home, and also room to spend the night. The man bowed low in homage to the Lord and said, blessed be the Lord, the God of my master Abraham, who has not withheld his steadfast faithfulness from my master. For I have been guided on my errand by the Lord to the house of my master's kinsman. Rebekah had a brother whose name was Laban, and Laban ran out to the man to the spring. He said, come in, O blessed of the Lord. Why do you stand outside when I have prepared the house and a place for the camels? So the man came into the house, and Laban unloaded the camels and gave him straw and fodder for the camels and water to wash his feet and the feet of the men who were with him. Then food was set before him to eat, but he said, I will not eat until I have told my errand. He said, speak on. Now then, if you will deal loyally and truly with my master, tell me, and if not, tell me, so that I may turn either to the right hand or to the left. Then Laban and Bethuel answered,
The thing comes from the Lord. We cannot speak to you anything bad or good. Look, Rebekah is before you. Take her and go, and let her be the wife of your master's son as the Lord has spoken." When Abraham's servant heard their words, he bowed himself to the ground before the Lord. And the servant brought out jewelry of silver and of gold, and garments, and gave them to Rebekah. He also gave to her brother and to her mother costly ornaments. They said, "We will call the girl and ask her." And they called Rebekah and said to her, "Will you go with this man?" She said, "I will." So they sent away their sister Rebekah and her nurse along with Abram's servants and his men. And they blessed Rebekah and said to her, "May you, our sister, become thousands of myriads. May your offspring gain possession of the gates of their foes." Then Rebekah and her maids rose up, mounted the camels, and followed the man. Thus the servant took Rebekah and went his way. Now Isaac had come from Beer Lahairoi and was settled in the Negev. Isaac went out in the evening to walk in the field, and looking up, he saw camels coming. And Rebekah looked up, and when she saw Isaac, she slipped quickly from the camel and said to the servant, "Who is the man over there walking in the field to meet us?" The servant said, "It is my master." So she took her veil and covered herself. And the servant told Isaac all the things that he had done. Then Isaac brought her into his mother Sarah's tent. He took Rebekah, and she became his wife, and he loved her. So Isaac was comforted after his mother's death. May God bless this reading to our understanding and to our living. Amen.
I have decided to do my meditation downstairs here in our auditorium. It's a little more Muskoka-like here. I think upstairs I would melt. If you haven't seen our sanctuary, don't worry, you'll see it in other portions of our service. Let us join our hearts in prayer. Let us pray. O gracious Holy Spirit, shape and bless the humble and human words I speak, and the thoughts, feelings, and responses of those who hear. that this might be a time when we discern your story operating in our lives toward love. In Jesus' name, amen. Do you like hearing family stories? I really do appreciate the times when I sit down with families and hear the stories of a person's life. And you know, some of the favorites are when I ask of a widow or a widower, "And how did you meet?" In many cases, the family has heard that story before and they kind of nestle down and get ready to hear it again and add their two bits to it as they reaffirm their version of that story. Sometimes they've never heard it before and they listen eagerly. Whether it's a story of some 16-year-old spying each other across the dance floor in a Montreal amusement park, or of a couple meeting each other on the Brampton bus ending with a proposal after the sound of music. They're wonderful stories. They're heartwarming stories. Our story today from Genesis 24 is one of those origin stories, but it carries a very special import for Christians and for Jews. For this is the very story of the ongoing fulfillment of the promise of God to make through Abraham a blessing for all nations. And as we begin this story, that promise again is under threat, as it seems to be so often, because there is Isaac and he has no wife. So everyone settles down because we've heard this story before. If you are a Jew, you heard it all your growing up years. You heard it around the campfires as you came to put your caravan to rest for the evening. And they love to hear it again. The Pentateuch, the stories there, are told in such a way that they have a lot of repetition in them because they're meant to be told. And the parts that are repeated are meant to be heard again and again. And so we nestle down for these 67 verses of the story of Rebekah and Isaac. Now, I didn't read the 67 verses when we did it as a scripture reading. I'm not going to go through them all now, but I do recommend that to you. As I said in the introduction, it is a beautifully told novella. But here we are going to highlight a few of these features of this story, which bring about how we may recognize God's own story working in our lives with us and sometimes in spite of us. The story begins at verse 1, which I didn't include, where Abraham calls his oldest and most loyal servant, and he gives him the great responsibility of going to his hometown, of going back to Haran in Aram, the city of his brother Nahor, to get a wife for Isaac. And he makes him swear a very solemn oath that he will do it. Now, the servant, tradition tells us, was probably Eliezer, who was mentioned back in Genesis 15. Before Abraham had an heir, it was going to be Eliezer of Damascus who would inherit all his property. But now Eliezer is given this solemn responsibility and solemn oath. And Eliezer, in the way of many prophets and servants in the First Testament, when he's asked to do something, he first of all puts up the problems why he may not be able to do it. He tells Abraham, well, what if this young woman doesn't agree to come with me? Then he says, well, if she doesn't come with me, shall I bring Isaac to Haran? And Abraham says, look, if she doesn't come with you, you're free from the oath. You just have to try for me. And under no circumstances will you take Isaac back to my home country. This is the land of promise. This is where Isaac will stay. And you notice throughout much of this story in chapter 24, Isaac has very little to do and very little to say. The main actor really is Eleazar. You have Abraham and Eleazar, and then Rebecca and Eleazar. Isaac comes in at the end. He's very passive through all these stories involving him. But God is not passive. It's interesting in the stories of the two previous weeks, the story of Hagar and Ishmael and the story of the near sacrifice of Isaac, you hear God speaking a lot in those stories. In this story, God never speaks. The name of God is said 17 times to leave us in no doubt that what is happening here is somehow being superintended by God. We're told that God will send his angel to guide the way. Now, that angel never appears in the text. But we're also told, and Eleazar believes, that he has been led by God. The word nacha in Hebrew, it's only used here in Genesis. It's used more often in Exodus when God leads the children of Israel through the wilderness. And it's used too in a very popular psalm, the 23rd Psalm. He leads me beside the still waters. He restores my soul. He leads me in the paths of righteousness for his name's sake. Yes, God's leading is being felt throughout this story, though we never hear God speaking. So Eleazar reluctantly fulfills his responsibility to Abraham. He takes 10 camels loaded with gifts, and he goes off to find this bride. Now, if being reluctant to go wasn't enough, when he gets there, he kind of sets God a test. He says, Lord, let me see how you truly are showing loving kindness, chesed, that great covenantal word of love. Let me see that you are showing that loyal love to your servant Abraham by, well, when I see a young woman, if I ask her to give me a drink, she gives me a drink. And not only that, but she offers to water my 10 camels. Now, that may not seem like a lot, and giving him a drink may not have been too much. It's a bit of Middle Eastern hospitality. But to water his 10 camels. Camels usually got watered about every 10 days, and when they came off a long trip, such as from Canaan to Haran, well, they would be thirsty. And a camel would drink between 30 and 40 gallons of water in about 15 minutes. And there were 10 camels. We're told in this story that Rebecca came to the well, she went down and came up with her jar, and that would have been very similar to the springs or the wells that you see across the Middle East. They're dug down. There's usually a set of stairs down to the pool, and you go down and come up the stairs. Well, get that picture in your mind for what is about to happen. So Eleazar, or the servant, prays God this little test. If you are going to bring about success in this journey, you know, let this girl give me a drink of water and then just let her water my 10 camels. And it says, before he finishes praying, Rebecca appears. And a lot of things happen very quickly here. He runs to Rebecca and he asks her for a little sip of water. And Rebecca says, drink all you want. And furthermore, let me water your camels for you. And you can almost hear those nestling down and listening to this story that they've heard so many times begin to laugh here, for this little slip of a teenage girl is going to, well, drench up 300, 400 gallons of water for these 10 camels. I love the way the artist Robert Gavin depicts Rebecca here, a little slip of a teenage girl. It would have been fairly accurate. And she was going to bring up this ton and a half of water for these 10 thirsty camels. And while this was going on, it says the servant sat silently watching, wondering if this were the one. And I laugh at that. Here she is, running down the stairs, running up the stairs, pouring her little jug of water into the trough, and he's wondering if this might possibly be the one. Well, after all the camels have drunk their fill, he seems to concede, well, God, maybe you have shown me who this is. And so he runs again and throws the ring on her nose and gives her the golden bracelets, which she seems to think is a bit of all right. And then he asks her, all right, whose family do you belong to? You know, she'd already been noticed to be very good looking and to be a virgin, never known a man. She says, well, I'm from Bethuel, who's the son of Milcah and Nahor, who was Abraham's brother. This is the one of Abraham's kindred that he was looking for. I mean, it was a grand slam, and he said a prayer of praise to God who had led him to this young woman. And she really is an amazing young woman, because then he asked her, you know, where do you live? Do you think I could stay there for the night? And she, without consulting her parents at all or her brother, who seems to have been the household patriarch of the time, she just says, yeah, we've got plenty of room. Come on to my place. And so they went. Now Laban sees his little sister coming with a gold nose ring and gold bangles on her arms, and he says, well, where did she get this from? And he runs out too, and he sees the servant, and he sees more precisely these 10 heavily laden camels. And he also thinks that this is a bit of all right. And Laban, well, we're going to meet Laban later on in this story. He's going to become Jacob's father-in-law. And we get to understand that Laban, well, he's looking for a good deal. He's certainly not a follower of Yahweh, of the God of Abraham. We know that because Rachel steals his household gods when she leaves with Jacob, but that's another story. But here he sees this servant with these 10 heavily loaded camels and with his little sister covered in gold jewelry, and he says, hey, brother, at last I see someone who is, praise be to the God of Abraham. You know, if Eliezer was the reluctant servant, Laban is the one who seeks to manipulate God for his own gain. I don't want to be too hard on him here, but knowing what happens later and seeing what happens here, I think you can make a pretty good assessment that that is what is happening. Here is a wealthy guy who comes from a wealthy master, and he is going to take advantage of it in negotiating a dowry for his sister, and he does so. Now, Rebecca all this time continues to show amazing self-possession and courage. When they come to the point where they say, now, we want Rebecca to stay 10 more days, and some say that's because they want to organize parties to say goodbye. It might also be to organize a little more negotiation, saying, you know, Laban did this later. You just have to work for me a little longer, and then I'll let Rachel go with you. But the servant says, no, I want to get back right away and tell my master Abraham what God has done. And they say, well, let's ask Rebecca. And they do. And there's an amazing kind of overlap going on here between Abraham's story and Rebecca's story. For Rebecca is about to repeat the journey of Abraham from Haran to Canaan. And in Abraham's story, God commanded Abraham to go forth, lech lecha, When they ask, Rebecca, will you go? She responds with one word, Elek. Same sounding words that Abraham used or heard. But in that case, it was God's command. In this case, it is Rebecca's assertion. And so they go. She gets up on the camels and they head back to Canaan. Abram disappears from the story. Suddenly, the servant's master is no longer Abraham, but Isaac. And Isaac is out wandering kind of aimlessly in the desert in the night. And he looks up and sees these camels coming. Rebecca looks up and she sees him. She asks Eliezer, who is that? Well, that's my master. And she hurries down off the camel, still hurrying, puts on her veil. And they meet. And they go into Sarah's tent, and there they're married. And the promise unfolds in its way. And everyone who's hearing the story claps their hands and says, isn't that marvelous? Have you ever had that happen where you're thinking about your story and you're looking back? Sometimes you see how you resisted. Sometimes you see how perhaps others tried to turn your story to their gain, or perhaps even you tried to manipulate something out of it. And yet the story unfolded in a way that you could not have predicted or understood. I remember one of those wonderful stories which I enjoyed hearing. It is the story of the meeting of John Capes and Margaret Holroyd. I don't think Marg and John would mind me sharing this story again. They love to tell it. I told it at John's funeral and then said it again at Margaret's. And the family nestled down and loved to hear it again. John met the, as he described her, lovely and vivacious Margaret Holroyd at the Sonny Rawson Dance Hall in Port Severn. It was one of those meetings that really shouldn't have happened. She wasn't supposed to be there. She lived in Orillia. But she had decided to go back to Port Severn to work for a little bit in the summer at a lodge nearby. John happened to be in the dance hall. Their paths cross in the way that these stories often have, paths strangely crossing. Well, she doesn't remember too much about that first meeting. John remembers being totally captivated, of course. She remembers the smiling man taking great attention and asking her for a few dances and then telling her that he had been transferred from the local branch of the bank where he was working to a branch in Toronto. And she said, well, isn't that interesting, because I've just been transferred to teach from Orillia to the lakeshore. Well, when they got to Toronto, they struck up a relationship. Margaret, again, a little reluctant, but John just about wore out the streetcar rails, and then because the streetcar stopped operating at a certain time of night, not too late, he wore out his shoe leather going down to see her. He lived at that time the end of Toronto at Jane and Bloor. She was on the lakeshore. And after a certain amount of time, John gave her a ring. Margaret hung on to that ring for 6 weeks while she considered other offers. It wasn't with her, Elek, I will go. But she finally did go. You know, as we sat and told the story after John had passed away and Margaret reflected on that, she saw God's hand in her story. And she did not regret her decision. You look back and see God's hand in your story. You look ahead and see God's hand in our story as we go through this time, as you go through your life, your story woven into the stories of others you love. We are invited to be affirmed, to be encouraged by God's unfolding promise in our lives. We perhaps are not at the point where we can nestle down and tell the story over and over again quite yet, but we can nestle down in the sure arms of God's love. Listen to this story unfold because we are part of this promise. The story would eventuate in the story of another young woman being called by another servant, the servant, the angel Gabriel, and that young woman, Mary. And again, when she was asked, she, with great courage, said, "Here am I, the handmaid of the Lord. Let it be with me according to your word. I will go." We are invited to continue to go with confidence in God's love unfolding in our lives. Let's nestle down into this story. Let's nestle down together into this story. Now, I'm not saying get comfortable. Just get into it. We may not have to haul 300, 400 gallons of water, but there will be challenges ahead. And sometimes we may wonder if God is with us in this story. But as we commit to love, as we commit to bringing barriers down, as we commit ourselves to surrender to the fact that we are of significance to the Creator of the universe, and we are part of the unfolding story of God's reconciling love in this universe, then there will be a day when we can look back on our stories, and we will enjoy telling them again and again and laughing at what God was doing to us and how we were being led through our wildernesses to the fulfillment of love. Be confident in the promise. Amen. Let us come together now as a family at prayer. As usual, I'll say a series of short prayers, ending each with the phrase, "Come, Holy Spirit." And I invite you to respond, "Fill us, flow through our world." Come, Holy Spirit, fill us, flow through our world. Let us join our hearts together. Let us pray. O gracious Lord, you know us, you know our stories. You work with us, you work in spite of us, that your story may be told and may be lived, your promise may be fulfilled. And in that truth, we know that you hear our prayers and answer. Come, Holy Spirit. We pray for those who feel they walk uncertain paths, who don't know how to go forward, who do not feel led, who feel lost in the wilderness. For those who do not know whether you are with them, and those who are impatient with your faithful love. We pray for the two Michaels languishing in prisons because of false and self-serving stories among nations. And we pray for the people of Hong Kong as they seem to be overwhelmed by another story, the story of a bully. Lord, we pray for their freedom and we pray for their dignity. We pray for the great nation to the south of us, our good neighbors and fellow North Americans, as they celebrate their birthday and deal with a growing pandemic. As they continue into their election time, we ask that you bless them with the spirit of service and unity. We pray that people might protest in peace and in safety, that all voices might be heard and no bullies might silence anyone. We pray for those who are dealing with flooding in Manitoba and British Columbia and in Japan. We pray for those who are going through drought and needing rain, our farmers in Ontario. We pray for the victims of shootings and that all might lay their weapons down, especially when they are dealing with mental issues, that they might turn to help rather than guns, and especially when they are teenagers. Lord, we pray for those who are suffering from COVID-19 and those who are caring for them here in Toronto, throughout Canada, and around the world. We pray especially for our migrant laborers who feed us and deserve to be treated well by us. We pray for those who are suffering from pandemic fatigue. Help us to maintain our vigilance and our care for one another by keeping our distance, by washing our hands, by doing the things which end this illness. Help us to see the most vulnerable and remember them in all our actions. Lord, we pray for peace. We pray for the hungry. We pray for the lonely. We pray for the afraid. We pray for those who do not feel part of a story or a promise. Come, Holy Spirit. Lord, I pray for this, our family of Kingsway Lambton, for everyone listening to this worship service, for their families, for those about whom they are concerned, and for those with whom they have differences. Be with each in such a way that knowing your story in their lives may make a difference to them, that they might be reconciled with all those around them. We pray especially for those who are grieving at this time, for those who are remembering someone they love. We pray for those who are ill. We pray for Mona and Janine as she supports her. We pray for Libby after a slight stroke and now in Toronto rehab, for Susan, David, and Jane and family as they support her. We pray for friends of Duncan and Wendy, for Barb, who's in the late stages of pancreatic cancer, her husband Bill and son Ryan, as they walk with her in this precious time. We pray for Fred as he settles in at Humber Heights, and give you thanks for signs that come through ice cream trucks. We pray for anyone dealing with pain while waiting for surgery, and we pray that that surgery happens. We pray for those who are dealing with cancer and cancer treatments. We pray for caregivers who face special challenges during this time of pandemic. We pray for those dealing with Parkinson's and the new challenges that it can bring. For those dealing with dementia and depression, with heart disease and diabetes, and those who are trying to overcome addictions, and the voices of those who lure them to destructive stories not framed by love. We pray for parents who are trying to meet the needs of their work and their children, and I pray that they find some time for themselves, or their story too is important. We pray for those who have other concerns that weigh on them, that makes it hard to find their way, to fulfill their promises. Lord, let your breath of life come to them. Let your story lift them up, that they may know their dignity as children of God, and the promise which is unfolding with them and through them. Come, Holy Spirit. Listen now, Lord, as we bring you other concerns and other thanksgiving in the quiet of our own hearts. for all the silent prayers. Come, Holy Spirit. Lord, you do fill us. You flow through our lives. You flow through our world. You unfold in ways that we cannot see until we look back upon our lives and see you leading us and see forward in our lives and know your hope guiding us. For these gifts, for your watering of our camels, our hearts, and our hopes, we give you our thanks and praise. In Jesus' name, amen. It has been wonderful to share this service of worship with you. I don't know what time you were watching it, but if it happens to be Sunday morning, July the 5th, and it's not 11:30 yet, I invite you to join us for our modified lemonade on the lawn. There will be spots out there to help us with our 2-meter social distancing. If you want to wear a mask, you're welcome to. We will be outside, so that is not mandatory, but we do ask you to bring your own lemonade, your own lawn chair, and stay in the shade. It's a hot day out there, but it will be wonderful to see you. Now let's join together in our closing hymn. Lord Jesus, you shall be my song as I journey. Go forward now into God's story, into God's unfolding promise in our world. Go with confidence. We've got some buckets for you. There are a lot of thirsty camels out there. And may the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the watering power of the Holy Spirit rest and remain with each one of you this day and forever. Amen.